We're going to hear another story just now as I introduce Edie Irving, who's going to speak to us from the point of view of life and practice and work within a Buddhist framework. Edie is a psychotherapist. She's been involved with the Samyang community in Dumfriesshire for very many years. She's been involved in the founding and working still with the Tararappa Trust, a therapeutic centre in Edinburgh and in other parts of the world now for many years. And it's from that experience of living in this healing way as a Buddhist practitioner that Edie is now going to speak.
First of all, I just wanted to thank Jim for encouraging me to actually come along. I told him in advance that I was not going to be able to put together an organized talk for this event. I just knew I couldn't do it. So I hope that what comes out of my mouth has some value. There are some specific reasons. It's partly my, you know, I'm not very organized at the best of times. But there are some specific reasons. One is the older I get, the more I believe in what is happening in the present moment as being the only place where anything happens anyway. And anticipation makes me nervous and I often lose my place. So I decided I just come. But the other reason is that 2 years ago, almost exactly, the person who really has had the largest influence on my life since my parents, a Tibetan teacher by the name of Akam Rinpoche, was murdered in China. It was utterly unexpected. He was there as he went every year since the mid-60s. To go to about 100 humanitarian projects, which he founded together with Leah Peter from Switzerland, an organization called Rokpa, and working with Tibetans living within China, as over 90% of all Tibetans do, to remind them that their culture was a noble culture and they had every right to be themselves, and that he wanted to help. As he said to them, you're lucky to live in a country where the constitution says you have a right to study in your own language, you have a right to your own customs. Because even though the constitution says that, a lot of Tibetans didn't have that experience and they were losing their language. So he actually had a major, major influence in bringing back the spirit of his own people. I had once the opportunity of going there with them. And he was jokingly called the Minister of Education and Culture in Tibet, because he'd come every year for 4 or 5 months and travel from project to project. And he didn't hand over responsibility to any one person or group. Everything was by agreement with specific people who would always take half the responsibility and the group would take half. But when I traveled with him in Tibet, having worked with him in the West, I saw another side of him. He belonged to a culture of unreserved love and openness to communication. It was almost overwhelming. A lot of times I'd have to leave the tent and go and walk around a little bit, because people of all ages and many very, very ill people and people broken by their experience of poverty, etc., they would just come to him and in some circumstances just crawl into his lap. You know, there was no reservation to the love that he was able to offer to them. And that was their traditional culture, actually, was to share at that level. But food and health, these are the things on his mind that people should have their illness. He was trained as a doctor originally. They should have relief from their illnesses and food. No one should go hungry. So, but I only once traveled with him to Tibet. That was a unique experience, 2009. But I worked with him from 1977 until he died 2 years ago. Mainly, I did, you know, take religious teachings. I went to a three-year retreat, fascinating, amazing experience. I'm not going to repeat it this lifetime. But mainly I worked with him because he made the decision to develop a form of psychotherapy, which we've called Taro Rupa therapy, based on a Buddhist model of the mind, that instead of having original sin as the model of the mind, the model of the mind is original purity, which can never be damaged and never taken away. No matter what you go through, no matter however you manifest, as a monster, as a victim, whatever, it doesn't damage the purity of the mind, the essence of the human. But you know, each of us has to find that out for ourselves. No one can do it for you. No one can give it to you. It is the search. When you spoke of the search, as that is a key, because we're the only ones who can find this true value of the mind itself. But there are little words which are hints that it's intrinsically pure, its nature is compassion, its nature is luminosity, and I suppose, you know, why the trip to Tibet was so important to me. I mean, there's the poignance of hearing about his death, his, you know, murdered. I mean, for someone of his nature to be stabbed to death was just unthinkably horrible. But then, for my personally, there's a knock-on effect that everyone who was close to him, and most of the people I worked closely with were very close to him, how it's affected our lives, you know? I mean, it's, no one has not been broken to pieces by it, but at the same time, there's some other process going on, and the word that came the most clearly to me tonight was fidelity. That if you've ever had the opportunity to see what a human being can really be, you know, that there's no reservation of kindness or tirelessness, you know, working for others, but in a way that you're not diminishing yourself. You're not trading off your own value for the value of others. The value for self and value for others is simultaneous. That way of being is something that's, you know, somehow to turn my back and say, look, it's time to retire, I'm moving away, I'm going to retire. Instead, I find myself with more and more work. Two of my dearest colleagues have gone into long retreat, and one of them is just leaving this week. But those of us who aren't going into retreat, it's, you know, concentrated, the efforts that have to be made by those of us who remain. And the reason that I'm doing it is because I know that his insights into the suffering of Westerners, you know, he came and lived in the West for nearly 15 years before he did anything. He watched more than he did. People thought he was the janitor a lot of the time at Samyang in the early years. And then what he said was that we don't know that we're loved, that there's certain things to do with our early, the culture and our early upbringing, that whereas the Tibetans, as I was saying, you know, this feeling of love in the room, you know, was almost overwhelming, whereas we have a bit of the opposite of that a lot of the time. You know, the chill between a mother and her child was trying to get a little attention, you know, on the bus. You know, the mother just can't give that attention. That chill is horrifying. And what he hoped to be able to do was to create situations and give people exercises to do, things to get on with, where that they would directly experience their own value and share that with one another. So, in essence, that's what Taro Rupa therapy is. I mean, since attachment theory has risen, again, Bowlby started it, but it's risen again. It's been easier in a way to talk about this than it was for quite a long time. But the importance of people knowing that they're loved. There's another great teacher of our tradition, the 17th Karmapa, who said recently, we turn on the television, we see disasters of every kind, right, left, and center. That he said the greatest disaster, as far as I'm concerned, is a human being who does not know that they're loved. This is, and when we meet this disaster, if we can, there's something to do, there's something, and even if it's only to do in your own heart, in your own mind, there's something to do. The moment you know that this is the disaster, you know, all the other things that this poor earth and the people of this world are going through, is, you know, it comes from that. So I'm sorry, I hope I haven't been rambling on, but it's, you know, it is, and grief, people say, well, have you grieved? My God, you know, how can you not be grieving? But it's not a matter of stopping to grieve. It's a matter of making connections where there's meaning in it. It can't be, there are times of falling down, falling apart, but it can't be a process of doing less. As in my experience, you know, grief gives us a chance to make life more meaningful. That's my experience.
Edie, hello. Could I ask you, after Akon's death, where did it take you? What's
illness?
To where?
Illness, physical illness. I started having these horrible, you know, falling down, vomiting spells and things like that. I mean, that was how it affected me from the day he died. It took about a year to get myself through that one. But afterwards, it was just realizing that the only way I could betray him is by not working with the people that he had trained together with me. You know, it's just kind of brought, in Tibetan they have an expression, bone in the heart. And I had one Tibetan friend who once said, I don't think you have a bone in the heart in the West. But I feel like his death to some gave me some kind of feeling about it.